Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming. I'm Ricardo, and today I'm going to be talking about Quicksilver, how Cloudflare controls its network across the planet. Basically, in Cloudflare, we are big users of Go. We use it for many projects. And this talk is about one of the systems we build to handle one of our big scale problems we had. I work as a systems engineer at Cloudflare. I work in a team that built Quicksilver, and we are also owners of production, so we take care of maintaining the system in good shape. And I'm usually busy building distributed systems, which means sometimes I do more low-level coding, and in other cases, just I focus more on the design of systems that are robust across all type of failures that run in multiple machines. It happens that I'm a programming languages geek, so I got exposed to Go pretty early on, even though it was popular. And from the very beginning, I saw its potential to be a really good systems programming language. So in order to explain you what kind of problem we had to solve at Cloudflare, first I need to explain you very briefly what Cloudflare does, and I will tell you a bit more about how it works internally. Every person who runs a website on the internet knows that usually you have people visiting your website, and they are well behaved, and they just want to check your content, use your service, and that's really cool. But there are also systems, right? We have crawlers, usually search engines. They come to your website and they just index your content. We have also bots, like good bots. They just want to interact with your service. And that's totally fine. They just typically hit your APIs. But the problem is these days on the internet, it's pretty common to have large networks of attackers that they want to take down your website. They also even will try to exploit security vulnerabilities to gain access to your servers. So Cloudflare offers a service of becoming a proxy, sitting in the middle. So we are able to filter all the traffic. And if we take an attack, it can be a huge attack, or they can be trying to exploit any kind of a bug in your software, we will prevent it. Usually what we do is we just drop traffic that we consider an attack. Basically, we are a fancy CDN. So that means we make really, really hard to take down websites, but we also make them faster. In order to make websites faster, we had to build this massive network. We have presence in 193 cities, typically the biggest cities of the planet, so we sit very close to the visitors in those cities. We are able to serve content really, really quickly. We are very, very close to them. For doing this, we own physical hardware in 193 data centers. And with that hardware, we are able to cope with the load we handle every single day. On average, we are always processing more than 8 million of HTTP requests per second, at peak even 11, and we are very involved with the DNS community. We run a large part of the DNS traffic of the internet. And Quicksilver is one of the many more core components that runs inside Cloudflare to be able to provide this real-time service at global scale. So what does a Cloudflare service do? Basically, something very specific and special about Cloudflare is each one of our servers is doing exactly the same. Each server has the same capabilities. Each server can handle any HTTP request, any DNS request. Each server can perform attack mitigation. Each server can perform any kind of the functionality that our product offers. And basically, that means that it allows us to scale out just provisioned hardware in each one of our data centers. What we typically do is we just do capacity planning, and we provision more or less hardware depending on how much traffic each region of the world has. So basically, when a visitor goes to a website that is behind Cloudflare, it's going to hit one of our servers, and that server is going to take care entirely of processing that request. For that, given how our platform works, we need to install the same software stack in each one of our servers. Our servers are really, really busy. They run really, really hot. We have in them many software components running at the same time. We have software for performing the most general CDN logic, for responding to DNS queries, for performing attack mitigation, compressing content on the fly, web application firewall, and all the features we offer. Any server can perform any task. And here comes the problem. How do you handle the config of those servers? And when I mean config, I'm not only meaning basic settings. I'm only meaning user configuration. When we have many big user base, and when they want to deploy changes, when they want to configure how Cloudflare behaves for them, they need to deploy that customer data on our servers. And we have a growing customer user base, and we are global. So we need to deploy that config in each one of our servers. Basically, this is the problem of managing config at scale. is a non-trivial size, is gigabytes and gigabytes of config across thousands of servers. Sometimes config changes are triggered internally by teams. We have many teams working on each of those software components providing our service, and they want to maybe deploy config changes to tweak the behavior, to optimize some features. But many, many times, it's just the customers. They go to the dashboard, and they want to configure how Cloudflare works for them. Or even big customers, they usually hit the API so they can do massive changes programmatically. That means we start having the complexity of constantly changing. We have always a stream of real-time updates on the config, and we need to coordinate that across thousands of servers. At the same time, if we build a system for doing this, it needs to be able to cope with a constantly growing platform. We are all the time expanding as our traffic grows. So this is the reason why we started working to build this system. So if you think about this, you probably start thinking, you would need a small config service, right? The developers of that software that runs in our servers, they're going to come to this service and ask for a particular piece of config. So they will ask for a key, possibly, and they will want to retrieve very quickly a small value. So it's going to be like a DB, right? So and you will want to have persistence. So maybe you're thinking it has to be fast, so maybe an in-memory database. Not really. You want that if the server crashes and it comes back up online, you want to have that config still in there, because it's going to be gigabytes and gigabytes. You don't want to wait to recover the state. At the same time, maybe your process dies because it runs out of memory and it restarts very quickly. Still, you want to be able to keep the DB in there so it can go back online very quickly. Also, for configuration, probably, you can use a very simple data model. Just a key-value data store should be enough. Developers are going to place keys and values, and whenever a request crosses our network, each one of our software components, for example, a DNS query, will go to the service and will retrieve, for the event type of query, will retrieve the IP to respond. And it has to be really fast. And as I was saying before, we have thousands of servers, so we need to be able to replicate this config across all of them. It has to be fast, really fast. This software should be lightweight, because we run a lot of software in each one of our servers, and they are very busy. So we cannot run a really heavyweight database. And it has to be really fast. We don't want application developers to complain that we are giving a bad service just because our config service is slow. So hopefully, different teams will use this service. So these were the project goals more of a technical level. First, we wanted zero tolerance for inconsistencies. We wanted that when we deploy config across all our servers and over time, we don't find out servers with different data sets. It has to be identical. We want it to be crash-proof. That means if the software crashes, hopefully not very often, hopefully we fix all the bugs, but if it crashes, it should not corrupt the DB. It should be able to restart and keep working where it was before. It should be used to develop against it, right? It should have an easy protocol. So we implemented multiple protocols, and for the applications running on the CDN, usually people use the Memcached protocol. There is always libraries for all the programming languages, so it's super easy to start using our internal service. It also offers AC transactions, and that's related to the storage engine, which I will talk later, which is useful. And it needs to have a robust replication mechanism. It needs to be able to cope with streaming data across the planet, with bad network conditions and failures in general. And it needs to be scalable. It cannot be that one day we decide to keep expanding our biggest data centers and this system becomes a bottleneck. It needs to be simple to be operated at a scale. We don't want to overload our operations team with firefighting or to be doing all the time tweaking or manual change constantly. And it should not have single points of failure. No component should fail and bring down the system. And as I was saying, we want it to be fast. So for this project, the main two technologies we used was the Go programming language, which we use extensively at Cloudflare. And we chose one particular open source storage engine, which I think is not very popular, but it's really, really good, which is called LMDB. In terms of how we use Go, to be honest, it was very productive. And what I like the most is that the programming language didn't get in the way. Over time, as users of Go, we have experienced how the runtime has matured and has improved. And we have get to use a very stable compiler and runtime. And to be honest, has been very successful. Especially the garbage collector, we noticed every time there was an improvement. For us, was giving us even more value. But in general, we didn't have to do any kind of crazy optimizations. Then the concurrency model is always great for this kind of services. You can imagine it's a small server running many concurrent requests. And for dealing with all the requests coming from other pieces of software, going to the bin in parallel, that was great. We had to do very simple things, just limitations of LMDB, where maybe you need to stick go routine to a particular operating system thread, but that's like lower level details. But it was very C2. Also, in the Go community, there is a lot of emphasis on creating tooling not only for developers, but also people who monitors production. So to be able to trace a running process and get latency information, that was very useful for us. In order to be able to use from Go the LMDB stretch engine, we're using CGo, which is the mechanism to be able to call native code written in C or C++ from Goland. So that was very simple. There are good bindings. And we found the overhead was not problematic for us, especially because anytime you go to the DB, a lot of logic happens in the storage engine, and then you get back the answer. So we don't really cross many times the boundary between Go code and C code. About the storage engine we chose, which I would recommend if somebody needs to create one day a Kubernetes store. It's not the latest one available, has been around for quite a while, but it's very stable. And it's basically a small C code base, so it's relatively easy to embed in your project. It has good bindings in the most popular programming languages, including Go. It supports AC transactions, like other databases. That was very useful for us as a solid building block where we want to keep consistency so we could have like very same semantics of how to deal with data with concurrency. It's a very simple key value store based on a B+3, which means you can access keys in a lexicographical order. You can do point queries, you can do range queries, which is for us is good enough. It's a config service, it's really fast. We are not building a complex database. It has a MVCC model, which is also providing very same semantics for when you need concurrency. Basically, if you have multiple readers, each reader is going to have in its own transaction a stable view of the DB. So you are not going to have any kind of data races. And readers never block. That means for us, it was really important to be performant. So most of the workload is going to be read request. And we want to serve them all in parallel without blocking. So you can be writing, which can be only a single transaction of writing. But all the read transactions are going to be always never blocking. Just a small detail, if you use this storage engine, this is optimized for small records. So you need to be careful with that. If you look online at published benchmarks, it has a good write performance, not the best. But the read performance is excellent. It can beat most of the storage engines over time. It has a non-compacting design, which means it doesn't need background tasks to keep the DB in good shape. That's really important when you want to keep a system that requires low maintenance. When you have thousands of machines running this software, you don't want your operational team logging into the machines and performing like ad hoc tasks. Also, it does by design copy and write, which means it never modifies in place data. It always grabs data you want to update, and it writes a new version in a new place. That means if it crosses in the middle and you don't get the chance to commit a transaction, it's never going to touch the existing data. That makes it very robust. And when you need to restart the process, it never needs to recover from any kind of inconsistencies. Then another detail, for caching, it sits very close to the kernel, and it uses the page cache directly for caching. If you access twice or multiple times the same key, that is going to stay in a resident page in RAM in your computer. So when you go to LMDB, it's going to be extremely fast. It's going to jump very quickly to the kernel code, and it's going to retrieve the content really quickly. So it's very performant. But my favorite feature is we never suffer corruption. We have thousands and thousands of these DBs running all over the world, and we never saw corruption. I cannot say that from any other database in my career. There are always corner cases. Very once in a while, something bad happened. With this technology, we've been very lucky to choose it because it has been proven to be very robust. So essentially, Quicksilver is a little daemon running each one of our servers. It's going to handle only one single DB file. As I said, non-trivial size. It requires very little config. There is almost no tuning you can do. It just requires a bit of information to know to which other node to contact, ports and interfaces it needs to activate. Very simple. It has multiple interfaces, one for handling replication with other nodes to get the updates in the config. It has its own native protocol for client requests. We also implement Memcached for easiness for developers when they start using this service and they don't want to do any, use any advanced features. We also have a legacy protocol because we replace an old system with this new technology. And it also has a RPC mechanism to communicate with other nodes to ask for information to take decisions. It also supports multiple transport mechanisms. It can talk over the network, TCP plus TLS, which is the case for replication. But usually, the other software that comes to us for asking for config is over IPC, interpersonal communication. There is usually local software, so we want to be really fast, and we just use Unix sockets. And then gRPC for the RPC part. And in Cloudflare, we are very big fans of Prometheus, so any of our software needs to expose Prometheus metrics. So we expose pretty much any metric you can imagine to understand the behavior of the software. So I'm just going to cover a bit, a few layers of the software to explain how it works. And it's going to be what the client interface can do, what are the roles this software, in which mode this software can run as primary or replica, how the replication stream works, how we bootstrap new nodes, how we handle data integrity, and how do we do in general observability. The client interface, as I said, it supports multiple protocols. Depending for which purpose you use it, if you want to write config, usually people use the REST interface or the native one. But in general, in the CDN, people use the Memcache interface because they want to just do lookups and grab information very quickly. And it's a very simple protocol. We can call it from Lua, C, Rust, Go, et cetera. We have a few features because which are very important because configuration is very critical. The data set we handle is very critical, so different teams needs to be careful to not to overwrite a key space that it doesn't belong to them. So we have ACLs in place. We make sure one team never touches values of a different team. Just by mistake. We have rate limiting to make sure no team abuses this system. And we also expose transactions thanks to the Stretch engine. And those are very useful for the application developers because sometimes the way they write values in the configuration can be very tricky and it has to be written at the same time, in the same batch, in the same transaction. And they sometimes need to use that feature. Essentially, most of the nodes, most of the servers in Cloudflare are running a replica of Quicksilver. That basically means this software is constantly receiving a replication stream, where it's going to receive over the network updates to apply changes in the config, and hopefully all the servers have the same view of the dataset. At the same time, in real time, they're going to be serving config read requests from the software we run each of our servers to basically run our service, run the CDN. We have a very flexible replication system where we can chain together servers and send replication stream across any topology we like. In this case, we have two servers. One of them is receiving from upstream the replication stream and is sending to the next server. Then the same software can run in primary mode. And usually we have a single node in our entire network that does this role. And that's where application developers, they write the config that they want to distribute globally. Basically, it's using one of the protocols I described before, and they're just going to go to here, hit the API, write the config, and in very little amount of time, this is going to be replicated globally. And as I said, same mechanism, using replication. In this case, the primary is going to be in charge of replicating to those slaves, which are going to be part of the CDN serving our web traffic. Because our deployment is really large and the topology becomes non-trivial, we have in place some checks to verify that we don't do things that doesn't make any sense. The only property we need to verify is the replication is unidirectional. So we verify we don't have loops, we don't connect to ourselves, maybe we don't try to replicate to the same server we're replicating from. So very, very simple checks just to make sure we don't have misconfiguration in this system. So how does replication work? Essentially, you can think about it like logical replication. Over the network, you're going to be receiving small batches, which we call log entries, which inside are going to have multiple logical changes you need to apply in your local DB to update your config. And it's going to be a constant real-time stream of updates you're going to receive. So each server is subscribed to this stream, and it's going to apply in these batches. And constantly, you're going to get an updated version of the config. This is because customers, we have a large amount of customers, they're going to be constantly making changes, and we need to apply them very quickly. As I was saying, this is a very large deployment, and many times the complexity of the system comes from the deployment. So we need to start thinking how to make this very robust. First, we added a hash in the log entry, so we can verify the integrity of the changes we need to apply. We have an index number, 4, 5, 6 in these slides, so each log entry is sequenced. We know after log entry 4, log entry 5 needs to come later. But more interestingly, we also have in each log entry the hash of the previous log entry. We chain them together. And this is a very interesting property because we make this deterministic. Across our entire network, which is thousands of nodes, we know they see exactly the same sequence of log entries. And we know it because when the software applies a log entry, it verifies the hash of the previous log entry matches. And if it breaks, something very wrong happened. And this usually doesn't happen. When network is working correctly, we're guaranteed the same data, the same updates are flowing through the entire network. Essentially, we are running a loop where we are reasoning over the network log entries. We unpack them. It's just a binary blob. We use protobuf. We access to the fields. And the new thing here is we just get this list of commands, which are the set of logical modifications applied in order. And it's as simple as doing set operations to set new values over keys, or maybe deleting a key. For that, we access the storage engine. We open a write transaction, and that guarantees that everything is applied at once or nothing. So we have transaction semantics. And at the same time, those changes are only visible when you close the write transaction. That means, in parallel, we can be serving in a non-blocking fashion read request. And that's going to be the software of the CDN serving traffic. And each of our servers are handling thousands of requests per second, so we need to make sure the storage engine works for these requirements. Now, going back to the plan of data distribution, we said we're going to install this daemon in thousands of servers. So the first scalability issue we would hit if we would try to push this replication stream across thousands of servers is we would overload the primary node. We have multiple geographical locations. If we try to push in real time all this data, we will have an issue. So what we did is, here is not loading the background, but basically it's a map of the world with our data centers. We chose a subset of our data centers that we consider tier one, and the only difference is that they are bigger. They have the same capabilities as the rest, it's just we have more hardware, and it tends to happen they are better connected. With this, basically we can create a tier replication topology. We can create different tiers, and basically each node is only responsible to push updates to the next tier. This creates like a fan-out effect. Basically, the primary node is only responsible to send updates through a replication stream to a few nodes in tier one colors, in tier one data centers. And tier one data centers push that to tier two, and so on. We're saying we want to have basically a robust system, no single point of failure, low operational overhead. So we need to take care that the primary node is not a single point of failure. So we have multiple of them. And if one of them fails, it's very easy to replace. It's not going to interrupt the replication stream. And we are not going to have inconsistencies. The way we design replication, we make sure it's very easy to verify nodes are in the same state. So flipping a node is very, very simple. Also, when a node is replicating from another, actually, it can have redundancy from which upstream node is replicating from. And because I described before the way we chain together log entries, we can flip. We can start following a different node, and we will observe the same sequence of log entries. So we are guaranteed to reach the same state. And so on, we apply the same principle across the entire network. In fact, when we replicate within a data center, we only choose a subset of the servers to receive the replication stream from outside, and then we replicate internally to the rest of the servers. Basically, we never overload any server, because those servers are going to be very busy running other software. What happens when a server, usually disk is the most flaky part of the hardware, fails and needs to be shut down, taken offline, and needs a replacement, or maybe we are producing new hardware. It's going to happen that when the server is ready to be back online, it's going to be empty. It's not going to have a DB. So we have a procedure that is fully automated. It doesn't require extra tooling, no manual intervention. It's going to go to one of these servers in the same data center, and it's going to ask for a snapshot. And here is where, again, our storage engine, LMDB, is helping us. We are going to ask for a read transaction to have a stable view, immutable in time, of the entire DB, and it's going to send an entire copy over the network. We're going to write it relatively quickly, and once it's done, we switch back to replication. We can do that every day whenever there are hardware failures, we are producing new hardware, and it requires very little manual intervention. How do we monitor the healthiness of this network? Because it's big, we have thousands of servers, we want to make sure all the updates are reaching every single server. It's very simple. We just have a periodic heartbeat. A heartbeat is just a timestamp we insert in the normal replication stream, and we let it flow. Each server can check its own timestamp against the local clock and detect if it's fresh or it's stale. And basically, we use this mechanism to allow nodes to take local decisions to maybe switch and start following a different master, a different upstream node, because maybe the link is not very healthy and it's having issues, so we start replicating from a different server, and we fix the bottleneck. But in general, we have metrics, alerts, so if something happens and one part of the topology is not working, people, SRE, is engaged, and they will have a look. This is a screenshot of a real dashboard we have for monitoring production. We like Grafana, and each one of those green boxes is the average time it takes to send the heartbeat from the primary topology to each server of a data center. When they are green is because it means they are performing well, it takes very little time. And if we look closely, we can see in average, we can propagate global updates in half a second. That means when a customer makes a change, it can be updating a tier record, applying a new rule, a new caching policy, that's applied globally in half a second. In general, we just aim to have updates in a large percentage of our fleet under 1 second. But in general, it works even better. How do we guarantee the integrity? Well, first of all, we took care from a more logical point of view, how to make sure every single server of our network has an exact same data set. So we have a deterministic state machine controlling the replication and how we update local DB. But also, we are exposed to hardware failures. And it happens that flash storage, SSDs, which is the type of disk we use, when they're about to die, they can return garbage. So basically, we cover all the key and values with its own checksums, which we validate on the fly. And if we detect corruption, we just return an error. We prefer to return an error than to return garbage to another software, because that means it could mishandle a request, and we don't want to do that. How do we do observability? We don't like to guess. We like to put as many metrics in our software as we can, and we always look for evidence. It's sometimes very hard to understand what is going on when you have a pretty small fraction of a large fleet, and it's behaving in a very strange way. So basically, we need to measure if that happens. Because we wrote this software ourselves, I would say that tends to be easier to instrument because you know where to put metrics. And in general, we rely on Prometheus, and we have a global installation. We rely on Prometheus for all the scraping, running our queries, and building our dashboards, alerting. So that has been extremely helpful. Some final remarks. I would say this project has been a success because it's very simple and robust on its design. It wouldn't be easy to troubleshoot if this wasn't the case. Basically, when something happens, we can relatively easily understand what is going on. If it was a more complex software, maybe you would need to stop part of your systems, start debugging, and to be honest, that's not affordable for us because we run a global real-time service. We achieved the goal of providing a fast config service because it wouldn't be good if developers would complain that our config service is slowing down them to respond to requests on the CDN, so that was achieved. It's very well instrumented, which means the operation team can monitor this effectively. By design, it's very hard to make mistakes in operations, which not every single software follows this philosophy. This is in part because SRE team was involved in the feedback loop pretty early on, so they influenced a lot the design. And I would say in general, something I'm really proud of, we achieve a very low operational overhead given the size of this system. That's it, thank you.